Good morning. I'd like to welcome any visitors as well. We're glad you're here with us to worship and just to exalt our Lord together. Well, if you'll turn to Psalm 23, we are currently studying through that. And it's just good for the soul to spend time in the Psalms. And I think none more comforting and healing than the 23rd. And we're giving our attention to it for a season. So what I'd like to do is take back up in that, and then we'll go to the table together. Verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We said that's the foundational verse of the whole psalm. The rest of the psalm is really an exposition of that statement by David. The Lord is my shepherd. Yahweh is the one then who is over my soul, shepherding it, leading me to what we'll look at this morning and in the rest of this psalm. And the one who will finally comprehend and grasp the beauty and the depth that the Lord is my shepherd can declare, I shall not want. If God is the one taking care of me, it's Yahweh God shepherding my soul. I shall not want, I shall not lack. I have everything that I need. So instead of being the discontent American, always wanting more, I need this, I need that, the Christian is set apart and stands out in this world as a contented sheep in Yahweh's hands. I shall not want. I'm a satisfied soul because I have the living God as my shepherd. The beauty of the Christian life is to be one with the shepherd, to be loved by him and cared for him, and to trust him unreservedly. He's to be known and enjoyed. He's to be loved and cherished. And this psalm just really breaks through, I believe, the brokenness of our day, where we really have experiential religion without doctrine and truth. And on the other side, we have truth without any of Psalm 23, with people who are delighting in what that truth is about. So these amazing truths about God in Psalm 23 are for us to enjoy God in this relationship of being sheep to the shepherd. Don Carson, one of the most brilliant theologians of our day, he said about this when preaching on this psalm. He said, some of us just have a creedal religion, and where we have creeds and doctrinal statements, and that's all it is. It's no more than here is my doctrine. We just have a creedal religion. And he says, we have lost that God is to be experienced. True, you cannot build a life on mere experience. But if faith is just mere proposition, what more do we have than the devil's? What more do we have than the devil if all this is a mere proposition of I acknowledge these doctrines versus I have come to behold the living God and I dwell with him? So this is Christianity 101, and it seems to be lost in our day for some reason. And I'm begging God to revive us in him, that our knowledge of God would lead us to the place where we would declare, I shall not want. Until you are at that place, you are not understanding the gospel of Jesus Christ. God is enough for me. Psalm 23 really lived out in every one of our lives. The impact of what that would make for the kingdom of God would be historical. So may we enter into this psalm and experience the truth that David has penned for us by the influence of his Holy Spirit. And as we go to prayer for that this morning, I want you to hear from someone greater than Don Carson. Ephesians 3:14. Paul said, for this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Jesus Christ is our good shepherd. Shall we pray? Father, I pray that every saint in here would experience the things that Paul just wrote about. God, that by the gospel of Jesus Christ, as we behold it and lay hold of you, Lord, I pray that we would be strengthened in our inner man. God, that Christ would dwell in our hearts through faith, and that we would be rooted and grounded in love, and that we could comprehend the breadth and the length and the height and the depth and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge. God, I pray that we would lay hold of this shepherd. I pray for dead orthodoxy. I pray for mere experiential religion. I pray, God, that every one of us would lay hold the truth of your word that has revealed you, and that we would commune and know the living God, and that we could say, I shall not want. I have everything in the living God and this gospel of Jesus Christ. Help me to quit being discontent. Lord, let us be a contented sheep, a contented people with the good shepherd. God, I thank you for what we have and what we are learning in this psalm. I pray that your spirit would attend the teaching of your word this morning, Lord, that you would lead us to still waters, even in the word of God this morning. So we look to you. We want to commune with you this hour. God, meet us and bless us, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, this morning we will take up verse 2. David continues on. He says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. And so this first concept is he makes me lie down in green pastures. And I think we've all seen that picture somewhere in our lives of those sheep lying down in those beautiful green pastures. David has labored hard with his sheep. He is a shepherd. And there's something very satisfying to the shepherd to see his sheep lying down contentedly in the pastures that he has worked so hard to bring that about. But now David is looking at himself as a sheep. David was a shepherd, but he's coming now. I'm a sheep looking at the shepherd. And because the Lord is my shepherd, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. The great satisfaction of his soul as a shepherd is that now God actually brings me to those same places as his sheep. So what would David be thinking maybe as he penned these words? We need help here really to understand sheep again. Really, just studying the grammar and the syntax of Psalm 23 will never open up the fullness of all of its meaning. And that is what I want to uncover this morning, is to try to understand shepherding and sheep. As I've already mentioned, because of the makeup of sheep, they are skittish and they're very easily troubled. They have no protection system, so they live a very dependent life. And it's almost close to impossible to get them to lie down in green pastures unless four requirements are met. And so when you see sheep lying down contentedly, you know that a shepherd has been hard at work. It just doesn't happen naturally. There has been a good shepherd to bring this about. So sheep need to be calmed and they need to be cared for to feel safe enough to lie down. Do you think this is going to be very hard to apply to us this morning? This should not be very tricky. Sinclair Ferguson does a real nice job of laying these out in a sermon that I've heard him preach a while back at a conference. And he said, if sheep is to lie down in green pasture, this is what the shepherd must do to bring it about. It just ties in so beautiful to the fact that the Lord is our shepherd. So the first thing, you got to be free from all of your fears. Secondly, you got to be free from friction with other sheep. And thirdly, you need to be free from the bothersome torment of flies and parasites and ticks. And then fourthly, you need to be free from hunger. I can't sleep until my tummy is full. And so we need to be free from the need of finding food in our daily needs and our securities. And so as you look at these four needs for sheep to lie down contentedly in the green pastures, they would eat and then they would lie down and just ruminate on their food. And this would keep them heavy and gaining weight, the flow of milk and all of those things. So only the shepherd can help with the release from these anxieties. A sheep could not do it in and of himself. And so do you see the foolishness of sheep trying to get themselves into a place where they can rest? And yet my daily time in this world, I meet people constantly even sharing with me, I am going to figure this out. I'm going to get to a place where I can finally rest. I'm taking vitamins. I'm trying to get the right job. I've met the right person. And it's just this constant battle to get myself to the place of peace. I watch unbelievers every day with this. It's impossible because the nature of sheep. We are sheep. We will never be able to bring ourselves to lie down in green pastures. There will always be a fly. There will always be some danger. You will never get yourself to that place. And yet we spend all of our days trying to figure it out. And God's saying, I'm your shepherd. I can do this. I can bring you to this place that you're longing to, that you can't get there as a sheep on your own. Then there's the poor believer who's skittish, living your life that you can't lie down in green pastures. This is American Christianity. I can't even lie down in green pastures because my mind is always racing and my anxieties of a million different things and all the data and everything that's coming at me. I'm nervous and I'm worried. Oh, troubled soul, the Lord is your shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. This is the rest that the shepherd wants for you. I want you to hear that. The shepherd wants this for you. He wants shh, and he wants calm and peace as you get a hold and lay hold of this great truth. So let's take a look at these four things that needed to be cared for so a spooked sheep could lie down. I want you to lie down this morning. That's been my prayer for everyone in this flock. I want you to lie down in green pastures. So come with me, brothers and sisters, and let's look at the shepherd. Philip Keller said this. He said he was a shepherd, for those who weren't here the last 2 weeks. He said, nothing so quieted and reassured the sheep as to see me in the field. And so when they would see the shepherd, it just would bring this calm to the sheep. And so the answer is the shepherd. And so, guys, there's no substitute in the Christian life than that the shepherd is nearby. He's close. He's a very near God. He's brought us close in Jesus Christ. There's nothing like the shepherd's presence then to dispel your fears, to remove your panic, to take away the terror of the unknown is the God that we know in the future, to be fed in the daily nuisances of life. The shepherd's presence is the cure for all of these things. So that is really the first thing that needs to be taken care of before we can rest, is the sheep have to be free from all of their fears. We need that the perfect love of the good shepherd to drive out all of our fears, because fear involves judgment. And he wants to set us free in that. Sheep will never lie down until they're free from all of their fears. And so we will never truly rest until we're free from all of our fears. And I just, it's so peaceful and beautiful what God is offering to us as his sheep. So we need to be free of, I just got to provide for my kids. There's this constant weight, is I got to make sure they're cared for. I want to be a proper husband. There's kind of a weight, some of these, I like when young guys get married and there's a burden, like, I want to be a good husband. And I pray that you don't lose that 40 years into it. I want to be a proper parent. There's this constant stress of parents of, I got to be the perfect parent. And you're always stressed. Because I didn't feed them at the right time, I bottle fed instead of breastfed, I've ruined my child. And there's this constant burden and weight that just sits on you. I hope my health holds up so my kids don't have to grow up without a dad. The fear of that cop knocking at my door with the news I don't ever want to hear. An economy that's turning, global warming. There's just a million different things. And the good shepherd is ours. And his presence can drive out all of your fears so that we can rest. So let me just ask you as we begin. Is that you? How about you? Are you resting? Do you know anything about what I'm talking about? Just let him say shh to your soul like he did in that storm with the waves this morning. Because no one can tell what a day can bring. And we're either going to live in a sense of anxiety and fear and worry and dread, or we're going to live in a sense of quiet and rest because the Lord is my shepherd. So which is it for you? I want to lead you to this sweet place and not have you live anxious all of your days with the cares of this world that choke out the good seed that has been sown. The good shepherd can make us lie down in green pastures, just satisfied with no fear. You know how he does this? Jesus says, it's good that I go away in that little upper room discourse. It's good that I go away. And why? Well, I'm going to send my Spirit. And the Spirit is going to come now. You've all watched me from the external. You've seen me with your eyes. I've lived with you. I've dwelt with you. But I'm going to send my Holy Spirit within you, and He's going to manifest my very presence into your inner being, into your mind and your soul. And so now the Spirit of God dwells in the child of God. And that Spirit, in John 14 through 16, Jesus said He is going to come and be a floodlight in the new covenant. And the Spirit is going to put a floodlight on Jesus Christ. So this Christianity that focuses only on the Holy Spirit is not the right thing, because the Holy Spirit is saying, my role is to shine on Jesus Christ. So I'm going to make His presence and nearness and who He is, I'm going to make it in your heart and real, and you dwell with Him. And so the Spirit of God is going to come and manifest the presence of Jesus Christ to us. He tells us His Spirit will do this. He will make Christ real and near to us. And He will take the Word of God, and He will reveal the beauty of Christ to us. And as we see Him as He really is, never exhaustively but truly, we are melted with His love, and it drives out all fear. That this is the one then who is my shepherd. I will lie down and sleep in peace, for you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. And so that is the first point. Fear's got to be removed. And God has done everything in Christ for that to take place for the believer of God this morning with everything that you are facing. Secondly, tension, rivalry, competition within the flock itself. Again, Keller was so helpful here. As a shepherd, he said, in every animal society, there's an order of dominance or status within the group. It always works. He said, for chickens, it's a pecking order. For cattle, it's a horning order. And for sheep, it's a budding order. And so he said, you usually always have a domineering you who wants to be boss of a group of sheep. And his position was maintained then by budding and driving other lambs away from the good food or the good places to sleep. And it would just follow right on down the flock. Everyone, if I can't handle this one, I can handle this guy. And there's always a pecking, budding order within the sheep. I grew up with six brothers, and it was the same deal. There was a pecking order. The strongest guy won. And if you got to the bottom, me and Tim lost a lot. So when there is friction in the flock, sheep cannot lie down and rest in contentment. And isn't that interesting? They can never lay down. And the friction would cause great conflict, and it would spread through the whole herd. And the sheep would become edgy and tense and discontented and restless. And then they lose weight and become irritable. I just become irritable. I gain weight. That's not funny. But when the shepherd would arrive, the sheep quickly forgot their foolish rivalries and they stopped fighting. The shepherd's presence made all the difference then in their behavior. And that is what I think is Ephesians 4 in a nutshell, as chapters 1 through 3 is the gospel and all that you have in Christ. And chapter 4 now is to have this unity of the Spirit, to maintain it, to not fight and have all this conflict. He said, be humble and love one another. And so we keep the unity of the Spirit. That's the beauty of what the Good Shepherd has brought to the church. But the problem is just like in animals, in human society, there's the exact same thing. There's a struggle for status in human society. We want to fight for the inner circle. We want to keep up with the Joneses. And you see it in every business firm you work at. There is this stuff going on in it. Within every family, you have this kind of stuff going on. In every community, in many churches, every human organization, there's a struggle for self-assertion and self-recognition that goes on. And we fight to be the top sheep, and we butt each other to get there. And it causes great conflict and heart and struggle, to where sometimes you can't even sleep if somebody snubbed you. If somebody did something wrong to you, it'll literally keep you up at nights. If you feel left out, if you feel someone's getting more attention, then you will actually pout and will gossip about that person, will ram them. And the only remedy for this is the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd. He told us the world seeks for the top, but in my kingdom we seek for the bottom. I sleep better on the bottom rung. And it's a people that it's no longer about me, it's about Christ. And greatness comes by humility and lowliness in the kingdom of God. And so this can bring peace when the Good Shepherd is our focus. We can lie down in the midst of people fighting for the top and me not being there. It can make you contented. And you can lie down instead of just stressed all your days fighting and trying to get to the top, have people love you more. There's a freedom in Christ to be able to get to this place. Unrest is the guy always trying to get ahead, always trying to be the top ram versus the guy working for the glory of God. Which are you this morning right now? Are you the one fighting for the top, discontented, trying to take everything and win? Listen to what Paul wrote. He said, if there's any encouragement in Christ, if there's any consolation of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also the interests of others. That's Jesus shepherding you right now. Don't make it about you. Look at me, Jesus says. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. As we follow our good shepherd, it will bring peace to this budding order and conflict and jealousies and all of those things. It will bring a beauty to the body of Christ of all of us forgetting ourselves and coming under to wash the feet of one another. It'll bring peace and it will bring sleep. It'll bring you to green pastures versus the other miserable way to live your life. The only estimation that really matters to me is the good shepherd's. It isn't what everybody else thinks. That's what I want. And he has said this, because of Christ, I measure up to specs. In Christ, I stand righteous, complete. This is my son and who I am well pleased. I want you to hear what God says about you in Christ. Let that set you free from everybody else's approval and what they say about you. The good shepherd says mine, satisfied, beautiful, righteous. Do you want him more than the place of prominence? I pray your heart cries, oh yeah, that's not even a contest. Well, the third thing we need to lie down is the fear of torment of parasites and insects. They had nasal flies, bot flies, warble flies, ticks, etc., etc. And the sheep were just tormented by these things. And when they were, it was just impossible to get them to lie down and rest. They couldn't. They were too irritated and provoked. And it would make them stand. And they would stamp their legs and shake their heads. And they would even run off into the brush to try to get relief from all of these flies and nuisances. And so truly, the only diligent care of the shepherd could ever help them. They couldn't fix themselves of these problems. And the shepherd could apply insect repellent. He would dip them to clear their fleeces from ticks. He built shelter belts of trees and bushes that would be available to get them away from these nuisances. And so the shepherd, he watches them. And he sees that they're disturbed. And he takes steps then to help provide them with relief. And so the goal is really keeping the flock quieted and content. And so then they would lie down in the green pastures. And so the Christian life, as I've had many people share with me, you know, I do pretty good in the big trials. But it's those many small irritations and those petty frustrations that kind of stir me up the most and agitate me. I find that I lose my temper with these kind of things. I get tense and hypertension and dad's a little bit touchy. Don't go near dad. And so the little nuisances can disrupt many of us and bring us into a state of irritation. It's those little things all day long that will begin to frustrate us and take away that sweet peace that comes from the shepherd. And so the Spirit anoints my head with oil. The shepherd, he brings a quietness, a serenity, a strength, a calmness in the face of frustrations and futility. The Spirit, by manifesting Christ, can calm us in these day-to-day irritations to stay living in that oneness with the shepherd, peace, contentedly, and let the shepherd deal with these things so I can lie down in peace with all those things buzzing and flying around me. Come into the green pastures. And then there was a fourth thing that they had to do. You needed freedom from the fear of hunger. One thing I learned in my study is I always thought it was the places like Ireland were the best with the moisture and the green grass for the sheep. But sheep countries in this world, most of the best ones are dry, semi-arid areas. And most sheep flourish the best in that kind of terrain because the reason is there's fewer parasites in a dry climate. And the problem is in those climates, it's very hard to find green pastures. In Palestine, near Bethlehem, where David penned this, it was dry, brown, sunburned wasteland. And so green pastures were very far and few, and yet they were then the product of tremendous labor, time, and skill, and land use to prepare them. You had to clear the rough, rocky land. When I was in Ireland, it was interesting. There's all these rock fences around every house you drove by. And they said it was from all, it was a real rocky land. And they would take the land and clear it and build rock fences with all the rocks from the yard. So you would have to remove all of these rocks and clear them. You'd have to tear out the brush and the roots and the stumps. And you'd have a deep plowing and careful soil preparation, seeding and planting, irrigation and water, and then the caring for the actual crops. And so it took so much toil and skill and time if the sheep would ever enjoy green pastures. And yet green pastures are essential because the lambs need green, succulent feed for a heavy, mild flow in their well-being. There is no substitute for good pasturage. Keller said, "No sight makes a shepherd more happy than to see his flock well and quietly feed on rich green pastures, able to lie down and ruminate and gain weight. Great pasture lands are common to have lambs reach 100 pounds in weight within 100 days from birth if you do this thing right." All I can think of is how Christ works then to bring us to the place of rest. A shepherd had to work so hard to bring about green pastures. And Jesus did an amazing work, an eternal work. And as he hung up on a cross, he said, "Tetelestai, it's finished. I did all the work necessary to bring you into the sweet green pastures to feed. I have fulfilled the law's demand. I removed the rocks of your life, of the stony unbelief in your heart. I've taken away the roots of bitterness. I break up the human heart like dried clay, and I sow the seed of my precious word that will grow up into contentment and peace in your life. And so I pray that you would rest in Christ and his shepherding of his sheep." How few Christians ever fully enjoy the contentedness that God wants for us to have. I want us to shepherd each other into this. Let the body do its work. Get into it. And let's keep leading each other to these places to grow and be contented and live these kind of lives and expect it instead of just expecting to run around with your head always cut off and there's always a problem. How are you doing? I just want to hear someone say, "Man, contented," instead of the list. This is what's wrong. Boom, 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 boom. Just, "Man, I'm contented. The Lord's my shepherd." Wouldn't that be beautiful to have a whole flock running around like that, just baaing and happy and being led by our shepherd? I pray for that. For our good shepherd, he's provided us green pastures, free from fear, for those who will come onto them and lie down and find peace and abundance, because I've come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. And I'm going to go over one last thing and we'll go to the table. Look with me in verse 2 then. "So he makes me lie down in green pastures." What a good shepherd to remove all the fears that we have so that we can come now and lie down. It just feels so good. Come lie down in these green pastures. And the other thing he does in verse 2 is this shepherd, he leads me beside quiet waters. So again, sheep thrive in a dry, semi-arid country. So what do they need? They need water. And so the shepherd, he knows the best drinking places where you can get pure water for his sheep. That they couldn't drink running water. They're so spooked. If the water's running, they can't even drink out of it. So they needed still waters where it wasn't running, where it's clean, pure, and fresh. And so the shepherd leads the flock to these places. The role of water in an animal's body, they were composed of 70% water. Water determines the vitality, the strength, and the vigor of the sheep. And when the sheep are thirsty, if they don't have good water, what do you think they're going to do? They're going to end up drinking polluted water and the little puddles and all of those things, and they're going to get parasites and all kinds of germs and get sick. And so the question is, how does this tie into us, Pastor? Well, Jesus, the good shepherd, he leads us to water. He comes and he leads us to waters for our soul that is satisfying. The good shepherd leads us to the stillest and the best of water himself. I just want to read to you in John 4, where that woman comes and he says, get me some water, and the whole discussion goes on, and Jesus finally answers and says to her, everyone who drinks of this water shall thirst again. You drink this water and you're going to get thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I, as the good shepherd, shall give him, he shall never thirst again. His soul is going to be so satisfied in me and all that I am. But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. The water that I give is living water, and it wells up into eternal life with him. So Christ comes and offers himself to those who will receive him, to those who will believe upon him, to those who will eat his body and drink his blood, to the thirsty souls of men and women that are so parched that you only can be satisfied by drinking from him. In John 7, Jesus stood up at a feast and he cried out to the crowd. Now on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out saying, if any man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, from his innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. I just look out at this world and there are so many looking for God. I on a constant basis, I see this. They're on a voyage. And they're trying everything because they've been made in the image of God and they know it, and they're trying to find this something that I know I'm missing. But they don't know where to get the living water. And so what they're doing is they're drinking from mud puddles, false teachers and false thinking, and it's making them sick. They're getting sick from this muddy water. And I just pray that the beauty of this is that we've got the message. He leads me beside still waters to the place that I can drink, to the water that can satisfy me in a world of muddy puddles. There's a satisfaction in Christ that I find nowhere else. So when I look at this, there were three sources of waters for sheep. They could get the dew on the grass, there were deep wells that you could build, and there were springs and streams where it would slow down and they could come and drink that still water. What's interesting to me that I learned a month back, is that sheep can actually go for months, if it's not the hot summer months, they can go for months without ever drinking water. That was interesting. And what they do is there's this heavy dew on the grass each morning that comes, and so the sheep would rise before dawn and they would start to feed on that grass, and there was enough water sufficient for all that they needed for that day. Was that still water just that would be on the dew of the grass. Enough water for them from that source, still waters. And so probably this is the most important application that's come to me from my study here in the Psalm. Is the sheep that I see as a pastor, they're the most content. They're able to cope with the things of life that the shepherd brings. The fruit of the Spirit is in their life. And they're just bearing good fruit for the kingdom of God. And in every season, their roots go deep to the living water, and they bear fruit no matter what God brings into their life. And what I have found, every one of them are those who rise early each day and they feed on God's word. They get up and they drink the living water. And they come in those quiet early hours to be led beside still waters. I've been doing it since I read that book in the Gospel of John. I just can't get over the water there. And in Psalm 23, and I'm teaching Philippians to the college group, and I just can't get over what I'm seeing in Philippians. Just still, quiet, all alone, waiting for the shepherd's voice. And in that, the soul is so satisfied. I just get up and drink, and I can't tell you how good it tastes. And it's so beautiful and sweet to drink this water from the Word of God. Again, Keller, he shared the joy that he said he had every morning with the sight of his sheep, knee-deep in dew-drenched grass. Just would look out and smile and be satisfied. The sun would come up and they would go lie down in the shade and just ruminate on everything they just ate. And he said, nothing pleased me more. And I pray that we would get out of bed. We'd get out of bed. Some of you have health issues and don't sweat at that. But get out of bed if you're able, in the quietness of the morning before all of it rushes in. And no matter, time isn't even the essence of how much time. Get with the shepherd, the good shepherd. Drink the living water that satisfies from his word and just ruminate on it all day and how satisfying it is. It just breaks my heart to watch so many drink from the wrong wells and they're just left unsatisfied. So many drink from sports. And I just... The playoffs come and everybody has got this high of my team's going to go, and then they lose and they're depressed for 6 months. And I just, drinking from sports, young kids, you're going to go change the world, do all these things in sports, and I'm just telling you, you're not going to like the well. It's got hardship and brokenness in it. So here's, you know, Barnabas encouraging everybody this morning, don't drink from that well to satisfy you. Your hobbies, just that's what you live for. And these hobbies are never going to do it. Partying, alcohol, drugs, sex outside of a marriage covenant, the pursuit of a diploma. In the end, if those are what you're pursuing as chief ends, you're going to be unfulfilled. There's just no substitute for the dew of Christ. Amen? No substitute for the dew of Jesus Christ. That is better than extra sleep, I'll guarantee it. It will do more for you than 30 more minutes of shut-eye. So I close with Jeremiah 2:13. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, to hew for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. They can't fill your thirst. They can't satisfy you. You've forsaken me. I'm the fountain of living waters. And so I pray this morning that we will learn the beauty of what God has given us in Christ Jesus. So let him lead you beside still waters. And may God apply this great verse to our hearts this morning, that every sheep would let the perfect love of the shepherd drive out every fear that you have. You would lie down in green pastures this morning. And you would strive to rise early to get the early dew of the living water from Jesus Christ every morning and ruminate on its reality the rest of the day, because it's life-giving and satisfying. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So what I want to do is I'm going to pray and then we'll have communion together. Father, I thank you for the beauty of what we've looked at. Lord, I do. I pray that this would be a flock that is so satisfied in their shepherd that we shall not want. God, I pray that you as a shepherd would take away every fear that has been brought in here this morning. Some of them are so real, and some of them are just worried about. And God, we need deliverance from both, the ones we worry about and the ones we're facing. And I just pray, Lord, that you would drive out the fear. I pray if there's any friction among sheep, God, that we would let that go in light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who didn't look for equality with God, a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself and went to a cross. God, what more truth do we need than that to let go of petty offenses and hurts? God, let us release them at the cross of Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd, this morning. God, let us not be driven by the little nuisances of life, all the difficulties of living under the fall and under the sun. God, let them not irritate us when we continue to look to you and look to the satisfaction of our shepherd. God, help us not to worry about where we're going to find our daily provisions. For you are our Father. We will find all that we need in our daily bread in you. So God, drive out all these fears. Let us lie down contentedly. And I pray, Lord, lead us to the waters. Let us come to this word and drink the beauties of Jesus Christ revealed in this word. God, let us not drink up the things of this world that make us sick. God, let us give ourselves to the things that make us whole. Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd. May we be a people seeking your face daily in the Word of God, and a people who actually ruminate on truth. Lord, it's such a busy world, nobody ruminates anymore. I pray we'd be characterized by sowing these things in our minds and our hearts and meditating on them and finding life-changing fruit from the Word of the living God. So we thank you now as we come to the table. We pray that it would be a time of sweet remembrance and sweet blessing. Encourage the saints of God as we look at our shepherd who was bloodied in our place. The Good Shepherd laid down his life for us. God, let us look at that and just be comforted and encouraged and blessed that he is our shepherd. And it's in that precious name that we do pray. Amen.